I'm glad to see you're all here this morning, and what a blessing to be together. I'm just so excited about what God has been showing us and the many good things that he's been revealing into our spirit. You know, the Holy Spirit tells us very clearly in Scripture that in the last times, some will turn away from the true faith. We're going to break free. Somebody said break free. And we're going to go deeper into the Word of God. We're going to follow the pattern of the tabernacle of heaven and support it by the revelation of the Holy Feast. The Lord showed me many, many years ago that I was to teach the Holy Feast in this church every year. And I just really believe the Lord really wants to speak to us here this morning. And this is what the Lord has showed me, that so many of us need to get to that promised land, that land of the full, so to speak, in our lives. There are so much that's going on in our world today, in our country, in our nation. I mean, the things that are going on all around us, there is so much corruption, so much problem. And yes, there's issues even in our personal lives that we need to take a look at what God meant when he said, I want you to live in fullness. I want you to live the abundant life. Amen. And we're going to take a quick look right now at the countdown to fullness. There was an actual historical event, and you can read that Leviticus 23, 23 to 28, where God actually established this as a very, very holy time. You know what Zion is today? It's the church of Jesus Christ. When God says, I am zealous for Zion, and in another place he says, I am jealous. In other words, he wants us for himself. Amen. Setting the stage for this, and I'm going to go through this quickly to get into what God has showed me here for today. There is a scripture in Hebrews, the 12th chapter, and this is a very important passage where it says that we no longer come to Mount Sinai, but we go to Mount Zion, and it's called a spiritual Mount Zion, which is the church of Jesus Christ. Amen. And then, of course, the Lord told the children of Israel after they had come into Mount Sinai and the whole Mount Sinai area there, he said, don't circle the mountain. Don't stay here. I've got something so much more and so much better for you. So much better for you. He was talking about the promised land. And today in the church, that's exactly what we're referring to here. Amen. God's got something so much better for us, guys. Amen. Hallelujah. Sad to say, the country of Israel chose to stay and circle the mountain. That was a real problem. They did that. And then, of course, they did not enter into the promised land. Only Joshua and Caleb entered into the promised land. But that wasn't necessary. Everybody was welcome. Everybody could have done that. Today, it's the same thing with us. It is our choice that we make whether we go into the life of the full and live the abundant life or stay where you are. And God wants us and he has so much more for us. Amen. Somebody said amen. But we'll look at it. It's Rosh Hashanah, which we started to celebrate this week. The days of all of which we're in now. Technically, Yom Kippur, the 10th High Holy Day, which is next week. And then, of course, Sukkot, which is the time of rejoicing and fullness. But let's look closer and look at this countdown to fullness under the Old Covenant versus the New Covenant or versus the New Testament church. Let's do this quickly. Under the Old Covenant, Yom Teruah was the blowing of the shofars, the trumpets, and they were blown for 9 reasons for 9 days. In the New Testament church, the Feast of Trumpets is really represented by the fivefold ministry. The fivefold ministry gives the wake-up call to the church and to anyone who will listen. To anyone who will listen for 9 biblical reasons. Amen. This celebration is also called Rosh Hashanah, which means the head of the year or the birthday of the world or the anniversary of creation. Or commonly called the Jewish New Year. Under the Old Covenant, Teshuvah, the 9 days of awe and times of repentance. After the trumpets were blown on Yom Teruah, then there was Teshuvah, which meant 9 days of contemplation and repentance. Times of repentance. Of course, today in the New Testament church, this time of contemplation and self-examination, listen carefully. The days of awe are a period of time in our lives, in your life and in my life, where you, number one, reevaluate what you have done with Jesus. Number two, reevaluate your personal relationship with Him. Number three, reevaluate God's call on your life. Number four, identify what you need to change. And number five, to repent and to receive cleansing through the blood of Jesus Christ. So when I say the days of awe, that's what it's referring to in the New Testament church. It's not 9 24-hour periods. That's not what I'm talking about. We're talking about a period in your life where God reaches you and brings you into this time of contemplation, self-examination, and repentance. Under the old covenant, Yom Kippur simply meant day of covering. Day of covering, the 10th and the high holy day. This was the day of the year that the high priest interceded in the holy place with the blood of a lamb to cover the sins of the people. Amen. In the New Testament church, known as Yom Kippur, but now a day of restoration and refreshment. Our sins have been eradicated. Nobody has to cover my sins anymore. They're not there. They're removed. Amen. My sins have been eradicated at the cross. Now there is no condemnation to those that are in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Somebody said hallelujah. Hallelujah. Under the old covenant, Sukkot, when the early and latter rains came together for a year-end celebration harvest, not matched by any other. And it was a time of incredible excitement, a time of joy, year-end celebration, music, dancing, and feasting, without a doubt. In the New Testament church, the Feast of Tabernacles, this is God's appointed time for the end of the church age. Amen. Fullness of joy, healing, divine provision, abundance, authority, and power. All of this, the anointing of the Holy Spirit, it all increases right prior to the rapture. And I believe it's going to be done so that we can get more people into the ark of safety. Amen. In the New Testament church, the Feast of Tabernacles represents, this is an awesome experience that will mark the period just prior to the rapture when the greatest anointing and the greatest provision will be demonstrated to bring souls to Christ. Amen. Somebody said amen. Amen. In the New Testament church, the Feast of Tabernacles can also be a personal experience whenever you choose to surrender yourself to Him at that level. You don't have to wait for everybody else. You say, well, I'm waiting for everybody else in the church to get on with it so that I can really, go higher with it. No, we don't have to wait for anybody. Amen. It can be a personal experience whenever you choose to surrender yourself to Him at that level. Somebody said, praise the Lord at that one. Amen. In the New Testament church, the Feast of Tabernacles, this is your time in your life when you, step into a level of joy and peace that you've never known before. You will experience spiritual authority. Everybody say it with me. Say spiritual authority, overcoming power, healing and miracles, supernatural provision and incredible wisdom. Amen. This is all going to increase, guys. Amen. I believe this with all of my heart. This is the goal of every Christian, to live the abundant life spoken of by Jesus Himself. Amen. Why would we not want to live the abundant life? Why would we choose not to do that? Amen. In the New Testament church and the Feast of Tabernacles, tabernacles will be fully experienced to the fullest extent during the millennial reign of Christ. That thousand-year reign of Christ, and that'll be in preparation for our eternal state. Because even now at this time, Satan is still alive and still roaming around as it were on the earth. There is demonic activity. Now, the blood of Christ gives us power to overcome all that, but then at the millennial reign, the false prophet, the Antichrist, will have been thrown into the lake of fire, and Satan himself will have been bound in a bottomless pit for 1,000 years. Amen. have no power over you whatsoever. Amen. So the millennial reign will be a different level. Amen. And we will experience that. And then, of course, after that, there's a lot of things that will happen, and we won't get into that today. But it's an all in a preparation for our eternal state. On Thursday night, I went through this whole timeline with you. Go back and listen to that video if you want the detail. It goes back to 1500 BC, Moses and the giving of the law, right on through the new heaven and the new earth and our eternal state. A very important timeline that you need to know. Go back and listen to that video and you can get that. Today, this is really important. We need to understand the biblical significance of the shofar. We have the shofar blown in our sanctuary and always have from the beginning of this church. Dan Munyon is officially the shofar blower. Don't ask me to blow it. It won't sound good. You got to know how to blow one of those things, right, Dan? You got to set your mouth and your lips and all just right. But anyway, that's the practical side. But on the spiritual side, there's a huge significance. This is what it means. The calling to repentance and to spiritual cleansing. Well, somebody say, well, that's under the old covenant, Pastor Steve. Well, if you want to look at it that way, help yourself. To me, the blowing of the shofar, the sounding of the fivefold ministry, which I explained a few minutes ago, that's how God uses through the work of the Holy Spirit to get my attention and your attention, and we get called to repentance and spiritual cleansing. Amen. And we are reminded of that through the blowing of the shofar. It's a presence of God in the sanctuary, just like anointing oil is the presence of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The oil doesn't heal you. We know that. It's a what? A symbol of the Holy Spirit that brings healing into your body. Amen. To confuse the enemy in times of warfare. Amen. Hallelujah. Boy, we need the enemy to be confused, don't we? Amen. To confuse the enemy in time of warfare. That's why we blow the shofar in our sanctuary. It's a very important part of the New Testament church. And number three, it's a call to worship. Amen. Now let's look at the scriptural foundation quickly here. And this is important. Exodus 19:19 sounded when the Torah was given to Moses. Okay, given to the country of Israel. And that was, we refer to it as the Ten Commandments. But of course, sounded when the Torah was given to Israel. In Joshua 6:20, used when the walls of Jericho fell. Amen. Hallelujah. You can praise the Lord anytime you want, guys. Amen. Judges 7:16-22, used by Gideon to defeat the Midianites. Amen. And in Zechariah 9:14-16, will usher in, this is prophecy, will usher in the coming of the Messiah. Hallelujah. In Leviticus 25:9, blown at the beginning of the year of Jubilee. Amen. We're not going to teach on that today. A very important thing to understand. And in Isaiah 58:1, calling God's people to repentance. Amen. Oh, I got some more. In Joel 2:1, wake up call in the church. A reminder of the coming of the Lord. Blow the trumpet in Zion. Amen. And set a solemn assembly. Amen. This is so important. Wake up call in the church. Reminder of the coming of the Lord. And in Revelations 1:9, John's revelation of Jesus Christ was declared by the shofar. In 1 Thessalonians 4:16, it will be blown at the rapture of the church. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's look closer. Are you ready now? Tell me if you're ready to go into this message here this morning. Let me hear that a little bit more. You ready?
Yes.
All right. You ready?
Yes.
Let's do it. All right. Why were the trumpets blown? And what were the reasons for the holy blast? Now, you will see that they had a meaning then, and it matches exactly what we need today. It was like Moses knew what the church of 2021 would be like. Amen. Reason number one. Dan, if you can blow the shofar, I know it takes a lot of wind, but if you can, that would be awesome as we go through these reasons. Just give us a shot on each one. Reason number one, the calling of the assemblies. Amen. Unity and oneness. It is a declaration of unity and oneness in the church. Amen. Reason number two, for the journeying of the camps. That simply means today that we got to be ready to move on. Amen. Yeah. God's got something new for you. Remember not the former things, for he's ready to do something new in your life. Amen. He wants to take you to a different season in your life. Amen. Hallelujah. I think we all need a new, fresh season, don't we? After 2020 and all the stuff that's been going on even this year. Amen. That's reason number two. And there's scriptures underneath of each one. And you have them all in your bulletin. You can take them with you. Reason number three, the gathering together of leaders. Amen. We need a unity of pastors in South Jersey. Amen. We need a unity of leaders. It's so important. Reason number three, blow whatever you can, Dad. Amen. The gathering together of leaders, unity of leaders. Reason number four, the sounding of alarms. That's called spiritual revival. Amen. We need revival. Somebody said, Lord, send us revival, oh God. May the glory of God bring all our people back that have not ever come back to our church, even after COVID. Oh God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, restore our congregation, oh God, and bring our people back. Amen. The sounding of alarms, spiritual revival. Number five, the calling to war. This speaks today of spiritual warfare. Amen. Spiritual warfare. We've got, you have the authority and the power over every work of the devil. Somebody confess that. Somebody confess that. Say, I have the authority and power over the works of the devil. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Amen. 1 John 4:4. Hallelujah. That's reason number five. Reason number six, the call to worship. The restoration of joy and worship. That's why worship is such an important part of our church. It leads us and ushers us into the presence of God. Hallelujah. Each one of these could be a sermon, guys, as you can imagine. Reason number seven, the call to repentance and spiritual cleansing. The call for solemn days. Amen. And we're going to be talking about that in just a moment. That's in Joel 2:1. Reason number eight, the beginning of new months. Amen. Declaration of new things. Amen. A new season in your life. Yes. Amen. I'm excited about that, guys. I can't wait to what God has for me next. Lord, in Jesus' name, Lord, may we be excited about what you have in mind for us. Amen. All your plans for us are good so that we... I'm getting happy up here, guys. Hey, listen, this is so beautiful, I'm telling you. The declaration of new things.
Yes, amen. New beginning. Hallelujah.
Who wants a fresh new change in your life?
Yes, amen.
Who wants a healing in their body?
Yes.
Who wants their kids saved?
Amen.
Come on. Who wants all these things? Who wants to see your grandkids filled with the Holy Ghost? Come on. All right. Reason number nine, the offering of sacrifices. And that means we offer spiritual sacrifices today. Let's go into what they mean by that. Okay. Hebrews 13:15, to offer the sacrifice of praise, the fruit of our lips. Amen. We don't offer sacrifices of animals today. We don't do that. Amen. Jesus has paid the price. The vicarious offering has been done. The blood has been shed. But today we offer sacrifices of praise. Amen. The fruit of our lips. Romans 12:1-2. To present our bodies as a living sacrifice unto him. Amen. A living sacrifice. Psalm 47:1. Oh, clap your hands unto the Lord as a sacrifice. Amen. That's why I often encourage you to clap your hands in the sanctuary and shout unto God with a voice of triumph. That's Psalm 47:1. Amen. And that's a sacrifice we bring to the Lord. Psalm 141:2. Lift your hands as an evening sacrifice. Everyone just lift their hands right now. Just lift their hands as a sacrifice to the Lord. Isn't that beautiful? Oh, Lord. It's a sign of surrender. It's a sign of surrender, guys. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Who blew the trumpets? This has meaning. Listen carefully. The high priest Aaron and his four sons blew the trumpets. And what does that mean to us today? You'll see in a minute. Aaron, his name meant enlightened. This speaks to us of the apostle. Amen. One of his sons, Nadab. His name meant liberal and freely given. That speaks to us today of the evangelist. Abihu, his name meant he is my father. That speaks today of a prophet. Amen. Eliezer, his name meant God is my helper. That speaks to us today of the pastor who is the helper and the shepherd. Amen. Ithamar, his name meant palm tree. And this speaks to us of a teacher, a gentle teacher that is articulating the word of God. So the biblical function of church ministry is what? Read it with me. It's right on the big screen. Evangelist, apostle, prophet, pastor, and teacher. The apostle Paul had revelation of this, and the fivefold ministry is taught in Ephesians, the 4th chapter, verses 11 through 13. And these were the men, Aaron and his four sons, blew the holy blast back 1500 BC, but their names meant what we know as the fivefold ministry today. Do you think God might have had something to do with that? Yes. Amen. Let's go on to the next phase. We're doing the countdown to fullness today. We have now covered the holy blast and what it means. Yes, it was actually trumpets blown, and we can use the shofar today to stir our soul, and it's a symbol of the presence of God. Amen. And the holy blast today aren't necessarily trumpets, but it's the voice of the fivefold. Amen. The voice of the fivefold, like I am a trumpet being blown through this morning. My operation of the fivefold, God revealed it to me a long time ago, probably about 30 years ago. I am to be pastor, teacher. That's who I am. I stay within that realm. That's who I am. I don't try to be an evangelist. I don't try to be an apostle. And I don't try to be a prophet, because that's not my calling. Amen. Although a pastor can prophesy, I did start this church, so that's apostolic anointing. It's not that you don't do those things at all. It's just that that's not my primary calling. What is your primary calling? Have you identified what God has called you to be of those fivefold ministry? That's a very important responsibility. Now let's go on to the days of all. On a global basis, harbingers are all around us when it comes to looking at what's happening and stirring us up and causing us to want to repent. Do we remember this 20 years ago? Yes. It happened in the month of Elul, amen, what we call September on our calendar. And there's a whole message behind that, which I won't go into now. The eclipse of 2017, first time in 99 years that happened. The eclipse took place exactly 40 days from Yom Kippur in 2017. Do you think that God had something to do with that timing? Wildfires in 2020. Look at the stats. I don't even have to read them to you. We all know what's going on with this. And of course, incredible Atlantic hurricane season. Incredible amount of storms. And this year, as we know, it happened again and even touched us. Right in Mullica Hill, not that far from here, as you all know, we had tornadoes go through there. And we have destruction in Mullica Hill that we've never seen, not in the 32 years that we've lived here. Never seen anything like it. Amen. There is a killer quake in Haiti, 7.2 on the scale. 2,200 were killed, 300 still missing, 12,000 injured, 53,000 homes were destroyed. This is what the Lord showed me is the spirit of teshuva. The spirit of teshuva is very simply something that we get a grip on what's going on around us. What is God saying in the world, even with COVID-19, the things that we've had to face over the last year and a half has been incredible, hasn't it? And I don't have to explain any of that to you. Let's look a little bit further. What is the spiritual condition of America? Amen. This is what the Lord showed me. How to fix America, put Jesus back in all the places you ask him to leave. We'll start with our home, then the school system, and our government, and the church, and yes, your own heart. Amen. Hallelujah. That's how we fix America, guys. Amen. Say it together with me. It's right in front of you. Put Jesus back in all the places you ask him to leave. Home, school, government, church, and your heart. Amen. Hate and racism, the spirit of Antichrist. That is a spirit of Antichrist. Amen. Martin Luther King said, darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. Hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that. Amen. And he was famous for saying that among many other wonderful things. Love is the answer, guys. The simplicity of the love of God. I was over at the nursing home in Glassboro on Thursday, and I spoke to the residents there for nearly an hour on the agape love of God. It was the most incredible time I think we've ever had in a nursing home. I mean, the blessing of these people, tears flowing down their cheeks, waiting to see me afterwards before they even ate their lunch. Because I'm there between 11 and 12, then they go to lunch, and I play the piano for them while they're eating lunch. I mean, these people are in their 80s, 90s, some even over 100 years old. What an incredible ministry. You guys need to think about that. But love is what I spoke of. I had one of the ladies come up to me, and she said, Pastor, that was the most incredible sermon I ever heard in my life. She's Episcopal, and I don't know what her background is. I'm not real familiar with that church. But nevertheless, she says she never heard a message that was so stirring to her soul. Isn't that a blessing? You guys need to pray about nursing home ministry. And wherever you can, help the seniors. It's beautiful. Let's keep going. We got problems in America, don't we? Reform is needed. We know that. Necessary vetting is important. But we need law and order in America. Amen? And we need respect for authority. Amen. Hallelujah. Very important. Okay. Anarchy and destroying of America. What happened, I mean, in this year's past this is beyond description of what happened in what, 47 cities? It was incredible what happened. Blessed are the peacemakers, is what Jesus said. Amen. Let's talk about abortions just for a minute. We're talking about this time called the spirit of Teshuva, the days of all, times of repentance needed here in our country, and then we'll deal with ourselves. Abortions, the spirit of Antichrist. Amen. Total number of abortions in the U.S. from 1973 to 2018, 61.8 million abortions per day, 2,362. Abortions per hour, 98. One abortion every 96 seconds. Do you think America has created a great sin? And not only this, but government funding, which is your tax dollars and mine, funds it to the tune of $500 million a year. Amen. COVID-19. Do you think that maybe God is saying something? Do you think the voice of God is speaking? Amen. We have the 91st Psalm, and that's what we've used, and very, very strong on this. And I don't think we've had a Sunday where we don't quote this. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling, for he will give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways. Isn't that beautiful? Amen. Psalm 91. President John F. Kennedy said, let us not seek a Republican answer. Let us not seek a Democratic answer, but the right answer. Amen. Let us not seek to fix the blame on someone else for the past, but let us accept our own responsibility for the future. I thought that was something good that he said. And then, of course, Abraham Lincoln. My concern is not whether God is on our side. My greatest concern is to be on God's side, because God is always right. Wasn't that beautiful? Amen. America has committed great sins, such as slavery, racism, abortion, gay marriage, transgender identity sins, and sins against the body, which is the temple of the Holy Spirit. Guys, say this with me. The time of judgment is real. Say it's real. We need to pray for America. Amen. Now let's look at ourselves just for a moment. The Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians 11:28 to 31 that we need to examine ourselves. Amen. Self-examination. What is our standing with the Word of God, which by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit proceeded out of Mount Zion, amen, or the presence of the Almighty God, amen. Do we respect the Word of God? Do we hunger and thirst after the Word of God? Do we love the Word of God? Do we love the Lord's promised return, and are we preparing for it every day? You get up in the morning and say, this may be the last day of my life. Are all the decisions we make and the priorities we set in support of preparing for the return of Jesus? Are we preparing for the Lord's return or not? Is that foremost in our mind every day? Or are we so consumed with whether the Phillies won or not? Or so consumed about money in your bank account? Or so consumed about whatever it is in your life that you worship? You can worship your clothing. You can worship your body. You can worship your car. You can worship your house. You can worship whatever consumes the largest part of you. That's what you worship. The time of judgment is real. But judgments turn into blessings for those who are walking with God, not differing from the blessing of the Shemitah. I've taught the Shemitah here in this church, and I will again. I'm not going to go into that today. But the judgments don't have to be on anybody. Christ has already paid the price. The blood has been shed. The cross makes the difference. Anybody can receive Jesus Christ. Anybody can be saved. It's a whosoever will salvation. Amen. This was a dream that I saw, and I prophesied over this church. There was a heavy cloud that was heavy laden with the promises of God. I saw this hanging over this church. This was like a cloudburst about to be released on us who love Him and walk in obedience to Him. Amen. It was like a heavy cloud, and I saw this. All we have to do is like raise our hands, so to speak, in praise and worship and honor to Him. And we could poke our fingers through this spiritual cloud, and the glory of God would come down on your home. Amen.
Amen.
I believe this with all my heart. That's why I'm repeating it again today. The transfer of wealth to the righteous to establish His kingdom here on the earth. That's in Proverbs 13 and 22. Now I'm going to go through this next section very quickly. Okay, so just hang in with me here. We're going to look at the Joel 2 prophecy. Okay, and this is important. We'll go through it quickly. Verse number 1, blow the trumpet in Zion and sound an alarm in my holy mountain. That's what's going on in the church right now. Amen. Blow the trumpet in Zion, that's us. And sound an alarm in the holy mountain, that's us. Amen. Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming and it is nigh at hand. Amen. Verse number 2, a day of darkness and of gloominess, a day of clouds and of thick darkness. The sun and the moon shall darken, and the stars shall withdraw their shining. Turn ye even to me with all your heart, and with fasting, and with weeping, and with mourning. Amen. Verse number 13, rend your heart and not your garments. Turn unto the Lord your God, for He is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and of great kindness. I believe with all my heart. And this is another sermon that God is prompted me to preach some Sunday morning, is to look at all the things that God is doing, has done, is doing, and will do right on up to the rapture of the church. And even during the tribulation period on up to when Christ's second coming, God will continue to reach out to mankind, reach out to mankind, reach out to mankind. The two witnesses will be a witness. The 144,000 Jews, they will be sent by God to reach out to the Jewish nation. Amen. And every one of us, we will be reached out to over and over and over, even during the tribulation period. For those that miss the rapture, even during that period, before Christ's second coming, God will continue to reach out. Amen. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. And that's in Isaiah 55, 8 and 9. Getting back to Joel 2, verse number 14. Who knows if he will return and repent and leave a blessing behind him? In other words, God has been known to change his mind. He doesn't change. I am God. I'm the Lord God Almighty, and I change not. But God will change his mind. Remember when Abraham prayed and God actually changed his mind because Abraham prayed. Amen. Hallelujah. And there's other examples as well. Verses number 15 to 16. Blow the trumpet in Zion. Sanctify a fast. Call a solemn assembly. Gather the people. Sanctify the congregation. Assemble the elders and gather the children. Amen. Amen. This is what God is telling me to do today for those that will hear my voice. This will go out on YouTube, but we'll put it on Facebook, and there will probably be thousands of people hear this message. And I believe with all my heart that God is calling. There is a spiritual trumpet being blown. Amen. Because the time is near. Yes. Amen. Amen. Seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. And let him return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. Hallelujah. You guys getting the message here? I'm going through this so quickly. Verse number 17, spare thy people, O Lord. Give not thine heritage to reproach, that the heathen should rule over them. A cry out of the prophet Joel. Then will the Lord be jealous for his land and pity his people. God loves us so much. Yea, the Lord will answer and say unto his people, behold, I will send you corn and wine and oil, and you shall be satisfied therewith, and I will no more make you a reproach among the heathen. There's a promise from God. Amen. Verse 21, fear not, O land, be glad and rejoice, for the Lord will do great things, and he will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain and the latter rain in the first month. There's a promise of abundance. Yes. And the floor shall be full of wheat, and the vat shall overflow with wine and oil. That's a divine provision. Amen. And I will restore to you the years that the locusts have eaten. Amen. Hallelujah. For your shame you shall have the double, and for confusion you shall have rejoicing in their portion. Therefore in their heart they shall possess the double. God promises a double blessing for those who seek him. Hallelujah. I hope you're receiving this morning. Verse 26, and ye shall eat in plenty and be satisfied and praise the name of the Lord your God that hath dealt wondrously with you, and my people shall never be ashamed. God says, I'll keep you from embarrassment. Amen. Hallelujah. I am the Lord your God and none else, and my people shall never be ashamed. Hallelujah. I think that is so beautiful where God promises us that we won't even be embarrassed in front of the world.
Amen.
Not being able to make a mortgage payment is embarrassing, isn't it? Amen. Not being able to pay your electric bill on time and your phone is turned off, that's embarrassing, isn't it? God promises that he would remove that. Amen. The outpouring of the Holy Ghost. And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit. Somebody raise their hands right now. Say, Lord, pour your spirit out on my flesh, O God. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. And your old men shall dream dreams. And your young men shall see visions. Hallelujah. Verse 29. And also upon the servants and upon handmaids in those days will I pour out my spirit. And I will show wonders in the heavens and in the earth, blood and fire and pillars of smoke. And the sun shall darken. And yes, there will be blood moons. Amen. We've already experienced that, and there's going to be more. Say, our God is an awesome God. Stretch your hands toward me right now. I need some more strength. Stretch your hands toward me and pray for me. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be delivered. For in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem shall be deliverance, and in the remnant whom the Lord shall call. You know, the Lord has given us an incredible pattern, and it's in the tabernacle, and this is a whole different teaching, but I just can't resist just going over this quickly. That's the inside of the tabernacle, the outer court, the inner court, and the most holy place. Now look at this quickly. Okay? There's the artist's rendition, and there's a drawing of the inside of the tabernacle. In the outer court, Passover, time of forgiveness, time of sanctification. The inner court, where the lampstand was and the altar of incense and the table of showbread, Pentecost. And in the presence of God, tabernacles. Listen carefully. Now this is something the Lord showed me many years ago. And it's simply, as you can see, as you are saved and go toward tabernacles, you just increase in your relationship with God. And I can send you this so we don't have to take any more time this morning to go through this detail. But this is like, I call it a GPS for your spiritual growth. Amen. Somebody say, well, I've seen that before, Pastor. Well, if you could teach it now, then I'll accept that. You hear what I'm saying? You need to understand it enough to teach it and show somebody else. Amen. Or else you don't understand it enough. This is a very important chart, and we need to understand what happens. Passover, unleavened bread, first fruits, Pentecost, trumpets, atonement, and tabernacles, and how it is a guide for your spiritual growth. Now watch this. This is really important on this one too. Okay, there's the artist's rendition and the drawing of the inside of the tabernacle. In the outer court is sanctification. Amen. In the most inner court, where you go in, the Holy Spirit baptism, and then going into the presence of God, which is what we preach in this church, because we are a presence-driven church, is the most holy place, full of power, glory, and abundance. Amen. These are separate teachings. I'm not going to go into them now, but the pattern is in Scripture. It's right in front of us. Amen. And it's a time to wake up. Amen. The great feast of trumpets. Listen carefully.
Now remember, we're going to say what it is. Okay? Let's get ready. They're going to read the word of God. And okay. you're going to be part of it. You can start.
Again, the Lord spoke to Moshe, saying, speak to the sons of Israel, saying, in the seventh month, on the first of the month, you shall have a rest, a reminder by the blowing of trumpets, a holy convocation. Tekiah! If the watchman blows on the trumpet and warns the people, then he who hears the sound of the trumpet, had he taken warning, he would have delivered his life. I have appointed you a watchman for the house of Israel. Shevarim! Blow a trumpet in Zion and a sound alarm on my holy mountain. Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming. Surely it is near. Teruah! For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Messiah shall rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. Tekiah! Of man coming on the clouds of the sky with power and great glory, and he will send forth his angels with a great trumpet, and they will gather together his elect. Therefore be on the alert, for you do not know which day your Lord is coming. Tekiah! Also in that day, that a great trumpet will be blown, and those who were perishing in the land of Assyria and who were scattered in the land of Egypt will come and worship the Lord in the holy mountain of Jerusalem. Tekiah! We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. Tekiah Gadolah! I saw the seven angels who stand before God, and seven trumpets were given them. And the seven angels who had the seven trumpets prepared themselves to sound them. There shall be delay no longer, but in the days of the voice of the seventh angel, when he is about to sound, then the mystery of God is finished, as he preached to his servants the prophets. And the seventh angel sounded, Tekiah Gadolah! Saying, the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Messiah, Adonai Yimelok Leolam Baed, and he shall reign forever and ever.
The Lord bless you, keep you, cause his face to shine upon you. The Lord God pour out his grace upon you, lift up his glory upon you, and give you shalom, life, fullness, peace, all the blessings of his love and the power of victory in the name of Yeshua, Jesus, Adon Olam, the Lord of all.
Amen. Hallelujah. What have we learned here today? What does this biblical instruction and prophecy mean to you? Do you have clear intentions to listen to the wake-up call and the holy blast of the trumpets coming from the fivefold ministry? Are you going to enter the days of awe and invest the necessary quiet time with Father God to identify the changes needed and then repent? Are you going to pursue the spiritual Yom Kippur and seek for the promised cleansing and restoration and refreshment that is available to the Christian? Are you going to pursue the tabernacle's anointing and go after the abundant life and life to the full? How much do you really love Jesus? How much do you really want him? Do you really want him to light the fire again in your life? How much are you really loving his coming and living every day, acting like today was going to be the last day of your life? Countdown to fullness. Let's all stand to our feet. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want those that are going to be serving communion now to come and prepare right now. And we'll do it like we've been doing it now for the last several months. We'll just go around the back of the sanctuary and up the right-hand aisle. And those that are serving will be standing in this area right here. And let's worship together. And let's take a few minutes now to give this holy moment to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Remember the importance of self-examination before partaking of communion.